Our scripture this morning, and if you do, we're going to get to it. There's a little insert in your bulletin I stuck in there this morning. That'll make more sense as we get going through our scriptures this morning when we get a little farther in. We're going to start in Mark chapter 8, reading through this morning. It says Jesus feeds the 4,000. Some of you have heard this story. Some of you heard the other one where he feeds the 5,000. It says, during those days, another large crowd gathered. Since they had nothing to eat, Jesus called his disciples to him and said, I have compassion for these people. They have already been with me 3 days and had nothing to eat. If I send them home hungry, they will collapse on the way, because some of them have come a long distance. His disciples answered, but where in this remote place can we get enough bread to feed them? How many loaves do you have? Jesus said. Seven, they replied. He told the crowd to sit down on the ground. When he had taken the 7 loaves and given thanks, he broke them and gave them to his disciples to distribute to the people, and they did so. They had a few small fish as well. He gave thanks for them also and told the disciples to distribute them. The people ate and were satisfied. Afterwards, the disciples picked up 7 basketfuls of broken pieces that were left over. About 4,000 were present. After he had sent them away, he got into the boat with his disciples and went to the region. That's a hard one. Dalmatha. I probably butchered that. The Pharisees came and began to question Jesus, to test him. They asked him for a sign from heaven. He sighed deeply and said, why does this generation ask for a sign? Truly, I tell you, no sign will be given to it. Then he left them, got back into the boat, and crossed over to the other side. And then shortly after, the disciples had forgotten to bring bread. They're into the boat now. They've got to their side, except for the 1 loaf they had with them in the boat. Be careful, Jesus warned. Watch out for the yeast of the Pharisees and that of Herod. They discussed this with one another and said, it is because we have no bread. Aware of their discussion, Jesus asked them, why are you talking about no bread? Do you still not see or understand? Are your hearts hardened? Do you have eyes but fail to see and ears but fail to hear? And don't you remember when I broke the 5 loaves for the 5,000? How many baskets full of pieces did you pick up? 12, they replied. And when I broke the 7 loaves for the 4,000, how many basket full of pieces did you pick up? They answered, 7. He said to them, do you still not understand? Let's pray. Father, I thank you for your word this morning. Father, I know it's a long passage that we read this morning, and we're getting more into Scripture, Lord, but today we focus on our hearts, Lord, particularly on the hardening of our hearts and how to stop that from happening, how to reverse that. Lord, and what to look out for, what to be aware of, Lord, so that we may understand your words, that we may come to know you better. So we ask for your help in that this morning, Lord. I ask for your help in presenting the word this morning. Father, help me to speak clearly and boldly today. And as always, we thank you for your living word this morning. In Jesus' name, amen. And we've been discussing the topic of prayer for quite a little while now. We took a little break at Easter there, but we're continuing a little bit on that topic today, but it's kind of with a twist. We're going to go off on a rabbit trail, as Joanne calls it. But it's for good reason. This message today, the title says, From the Heart, and it's in regard to the condition of our hearts, of your hearts, of mine, of as individuals and as the whole, the church is the whole. The heart plays an important role in our faith. And in our lives, basically, the heart plays that important role in our faith and our relationship with Christ, whether we're talking metaphorically or physically, either way, it's important. The heart is in control of so many things and responsible for so many things. So how does that fit in with prayer? Well, I hope this makes sense as we go through it. I hope that as you pray, like I said, we've been talking about prayer. We went through the Lord's Prayer. I hope that as you pray, whether in good times or in bad, whether great struggles or great joys, that your prayers are prayers from the heart. They're not just something we're throwing out in the air and thinking, well, maybe he'll answer it, maybe he won't. I hope that they're coming from in your hearts. That your prayers for each of your lives, our deep prayers are not for just small things, but that we pray boldly, that we pray expectantly, that we pray for great healing, that we pray for God's goodness, no matter the situation, that we praise him for his goodness, no matter our situations, and that we pray that he protects our hearts, that he protects us, that he protects our families. I hope we pray for justice and mercy to be served from God's holy throne. But most of all, I pray that in your prayer life and in your day-to-day, that you would pray that your hearts would not be hardened, that they would be protected from the influences of the devil that are strategically put in place to deceive. Pray that the Lord will guard your heart from that, and he will. Through the power of the Holy Spirit, that he would also allow you to understand his word and to recognize what is presented as truth and actually isn't. To understand and recognize the difference. To understand what is deceitful. We talked to the Sunday school this morning a little bit about the characteristics of the devil and how he's deceitful. He's cunning. That's his main characteristic. He's conceited. He's pretty proud of himself. And that's his goal, is to trick us, to deceive us. That's his end game. That's what he's trying to do. So this is my prayer today, because I know we serve a God who does not waver, who does not change his mind, a God that is completely good, that provided his living word for us so that we would know how to be saved, that we would know that we might live like Christ. That living word that he provided and preserved for us, think about it. Thousands and thousands of years we've had his word. He preserved for us, even today. And that word does not change. It does not waver. What was called sin is still sin. What was good is still good. Our salvation is still only through faith in Jesus Christ. And our access to our Savior and our God is only through prayer. So I pray that your prayers today are from the heart. And that among other things, it would be for the protection of your hearts. So I pray this today because the condition of your heart, the condition of our hearts, has an enormous impact on the church. The church as a whole. And I don't mean, when I say the church, I don't mean just our little church here or in the state or half the country, in the world, the universal church, they call it. Everybody who believes in Jesus Christ is the church. We get that confused sometimes. There's your local church, which is us, and then there's the church, the body of Christ, which is made up of millions and millions of people around the world. The condition of the heart is imperative to the condition of the universal church. Have you ever thought about that? Have you ever thought and prayed for the church as a whole? For the group of believers around the world? There's so many different circumstances. There's so many different conditions that believers are in today. Have you ever prayed for that? Have you ever thought about how the condition of our hearts affects that? How things start out small, but little changes get bigger and bigger and bigger, and it can have a huge effect on the whole. Have you ever prayed for the hearts of those around you, that they would not be hardened? Whether through deceit, through lackadaisicalness, that's a big word, or apathy on our end, it could be either one. In our scripture this morning, we saw some of the effects of a hardened heart. Actually, we see it often in the scriptures. Christ references it often. Even in the Old Testament, you see it as well. In the scriptures this morning, Jesus had recently fed 5,000 people in the wilderness with 5 loaves and 2 fish. He had recently walked on water. We're going to see that in a minute. And out of the hardness of their hearts, after seeing these miracles, they still didn't get it. Mark chapter 6, we go to verse 45. Immediately Jesus made his disciples get into the boat and go ahead of him to Bethesda while he dismissed the crowd. After leaving them, he went up on the mountainside to pray. Later that night, the boat was in the middle of the lake, and he was alone on the land. He saw the disciples straining at the oars because the wind was against them. Shortly before dawn, he went out to them walking on the lake. He was about to pass by them, but when they saw him walking on the lake, they felt he was a ghost. They cried out because they all saw him and were terrified. Immediately, he spoke to them and said, "Take courage. It is I. Don't be afraid." Then he climbed into the boat with them, and the wind died down. They were completely amazed, for they had not understood about the loaves. Their hearts were hardened. They were still not grasping who he was. They were still not comprehending what he was doing and how he was doing it. That's what a hardened heart does. Think about all those followers of Jesus falling around witnessing these miracles, one after the others, and some still did not understand how this was happening. How he was doing it, they couldn't believe that this could be the Son of God. Verse 51 said, "Then he climbed into the boat with them, and the wind died down. Then they were completely amazed, for they had not understood about the loaves. Their hearts were hardened." Their hearts were hardened. They just watched all these miracles, and they could not comprehend them or their origin. We witness a lot of that today, maybe not to that extreme, but maybe. Many people, even in the church today, are not giving credit to God. They're giving it to the world. They're giving all the credit of what God is doing in our midst to coincidences and luck. We have let the world water down and take credit for what the great works God is doing around us. We've let doubt creep into our minds. We stopped living by faith and are now living on fumes. We're buried in worry and in strife and in debt and discontent because we have let the devil tease us away with the desires of the world. As I said, he's pretty tricky. We told kids this morning, he makes it sound pretty good. We have come convinced that the world can solve all of our problems and that everything that goes right is a coincidence and everything that is bad is just bad luck. We have let the thought creep into our mind that maybe, just maybe, God didn't mean what he says in the scriptures. Or maybe somebody's changed it along the way. Or maybe the Bibles are more like guidelines, so as long as we hit a couple high points along the way, we'll be okay. When we accepted Christ as our Savior, when we sought forgiveness for our sins, if we have, or if you do today or in the days to come, we experience a change of heart. We were reborn. We were made new. You can be made new today upon accepting Jesus Christ as your Savior if you have not. The things of this world should not seem the same anymore. The desires of the flesh that we once sought after should not seem right anymore. And that starts even before you make that decision. The Lord convicts us. We start to think, well, hey, something doesn't seem quite right here. I'm not quite comfortable with that anymore. Or something's just not right, and we start looking, we start trying to figure out what the truth is, what's really going on, what's right and what's wrong, is what the scripture says, is it real? We start questioning, we start thinking, we start feeling a change. That's the Holy Spirit working on us. And when we make that choice to follow Jesus, the transformation becomes complete. Does that mean we won't be tempted? No. Does it mean we won't mess up? No. The problem begins when we start to accept those failures and temptations as normal and as acceptable, even as right. When this happens, we find ourselves drifting away from the Lord. We let our fear of the Lord, which once kept us safe, and we let that start to wane, and our hearts begin to harden towards the works of the Lord. We start not to see what he does in our lives and in the lives around us. We start to not give credit for that. We become complacent in our faith, and as a result, we're ineffective in our witness. Now, I've been praying about this for a few weeks now, about our hearts, about mine. I had a dream a few weeks ago. I'm not going to recount the whole thing, and I'm not claiming prophecy or anything like that, but it's been weighing on my mind. You can ask Kaylee. I didn't sleep there that one night. But this affected me. It brought to my mind the urgency of getting our hearts right, of getting ourselves right in a relationship with Christ. Or perhaps getting right with Him for the first time. We only have so much time to do that. There's a limited window. Though our salvation, and even those who have made that choice, our salvation might not be lost. But we're throwing away and trampling underfoot what we are meant to build up for our eternal stay in heaven. The treasures we're meant to build up for later, we're throwing away. We're turning away from because the devil's making the stuff here look pretty good, when really it's nothing. Now this has, as I said, been weighing on me for a while. And I know Jesus had a lot to say about these issues as well. So that's why we're going to get into the book of Revelations this week, and we'll be there for a little while. I want to look at his warnings to the church. I want to spend some time looking at his praises, his instructions, his warnings about the things he said were to come. And seeing where we are today, I have to believe that it's coming sooner than later. The Lord gave his servant John a message to each of the seven churches that were in the area that day. And the very beginning of the churches we know it today, that was them. He sent them these messages, each message unique to the issues of that church body and of the leadership. It started in Revelations 2, and we'll get there in a minute, where we're going to go back to those letters so that we can better assess where we are as a church, where we are as individuals, where our hearts are, where our priorities are in terms of obedience, in terms of negligence, the condition of the human heart, our sin nature. These things have not changed since the fall, since Adam and Eve, all those years ago. Though that has not changed. So the message here in the book, in God's word, are just as pertinent today as they were then. So I want us to go into these letters with open hearts and open minds, not to condemn, but to self-assess, to do a self-check, to see how are we doing. And everybody here is going to think something different about how we're doing, because everybody's going to view something differently. Why do you think we have the four Gospels? Four different people who witness the same thing. They're all going to have little minute differences because you see things from different angles. We talked about that once. If you were all standing here in the yard and two cars collided at that intersection, everybody's going to say a different thing happened. Or was this person's fault, or was that person's fault, because they all saw it at a different point. They all looked at a different time. So they didn't all see that they all saw the same accident, but they saw different parts of it. So each of you are going to think about this church a little differently. And I have a sheet, as I said, in your bulletins this morning. I didn't even leave myself one. But what I did, I put our name in there for this first letter to Ephesus. Because that makes you think a little bit more. You can do that with your name in scriptures often. You can put your name in a passage of scripture and it's like, wow, it's a little different when I think he's talking to me, when I realize he really is talking to me. And there's some questions on that sheet. And I'm going to do that each week for the seven letters. And I'll have questions on there because I want you to think about it. I want you to answer them. I want you to give them serious thought. If you want, you can give them to me later. If you don't want me to see them, that's okay. But it is good to assess ourselves. We had to do this in my ministry classes. We had to write a letter to our church as if we were Jesus. What would we say to our church? Would we scold it? Would we praise it? What would we do? So have that in mind as we go through this. Think of those questions this week. That's kind of our little homework as we move through these letters. And not just for your church. Take this to your life, too, as if Jesus is writing to you. As if he's asking you, if he's questioning you on these things. Put your name in there. We may see some similarities. We may not. We may agree in spots. We may not. But that's okay. That's part of reflection. That's part of assessing. So we're going to start in that letter to Ephesus. It's worth noting the title in my Bible said the Loveless Church. Not all of them have that title. This depends on what version you're in. But this is the letter to the church in Ephesus in Revelation chapter 2, verses 1 to 7. And this is what's on your little pamphlet there that's in your bulletin. It says, to the angel of the church in Ephesus, write, these are the words of him who holds the seven stars in his right hand and walks among the seven golden lampstands. I know your deeds, your hard work, and your perseverance. I know that you cannot tolerate wicked people, that you have tested those who claim to be apostles but are not, and have found them false. You have persevered and have endured hardships for my name, and have not grown weary. Yet I hold this against you. You have forsaken the love you had at first. Consider how far you have fallen. Repent and do the things you did at first. If you do not repent, I will come to you and remove your lampstand from its place. But you have this in your favor. You hate the practices of the Nicolaitans, which I also hate, which was a group of evil people. And then he continues, whoever has ears, let him hear what the Spirit says to the churches. To the one who is victorious, I will give the right to eat from the tree of life, which is in the paradise of God. Now the lampstand is kind of like your light on the hill. We talk about followers of Jesus being a light. We had that talk with one of our regional pastors recently, and it's why I like our regional pastors. He was deeply troubled because he was preparing to leave here from a meeting and go to a church that was closing, to a church that was shutting their doors for their final service, and he was deeply troubled by that. He felt their lampstand had been taken away. And he felt that there were several other churches in the region. They cover a huge region, parts of three states, I think. But he was worried. He said, there's several others that I fear are that close to losing it as well. And he said, how do you stop that? How do you convince them to turn before it's too late? Because sometimes it's just these little subtle things that build up, and they don't even realize it. And bang, all of a sudden, people are gone, and they're shutting their doors. Now notice here the Lord starts with encouragement. He speaks to their hard work, of their perseverance. They had disdain for wickedness, which is good, and those who pretend to follow Jesus. And they've not had an easy go of it. He admits that. And they have not grown weary. He's commending them. It's not just a letter to beat people down. There's good and admirable things there. He says there's good stuff going on. But he moves on, and in the second half he says, yet I hold this against you. If you put your name in there, that's a hard sentence to read, to say, Tim, I hold this against you yet. Same goes for the churches. If we were to put the church at East Smithfield, what admonitions or what adorations would make sense for us? Would it be better or worse? He tells them, hey, you've done great, but now you've forsaken your first love. You forgot about me. Consider how far you've fallen, even though you've done these good things. Because every church started doing good things. They had forgotten the first one, the one for whom they did all these good things, the one they were serving, the one they were fighting for. They had clung to the good and shunned evil. They had done all that, but how did this happen? How did they get to where has something to hold against them? We become complacent. They become complacent and stagnant in their faith because, wow, we did great. We got to this point. Now we can chill. They were no longer producing fruit. A church that produces no fruit, who simply goes through the motions, is of no use to the Lord. In other passages of scriptures, he likens it to the branches on a vine. Where there's no fruit, where nothing's produced, the branches are pruned and cut off and thrown into the fire. Look at the fig tree that Jesus cursed because it had no fruit. It was not producing. What happened? It shriveled up and died. Jesus does not say in this letter that it's over. He does not say it is the end yet. But he gives them this letter of warning. He's letting them know ahead of time, hey, we can fix these things. We can turn around. In verse 5, he said, consider how far you have fallen. Repent and do the things you did at first. Go back to what worked. He says, if you do not repent, I will come to you and remove your lampstand from its place. But you have this in your favor. You hate the practices of the Nicolaitans, which I also hate. He says, whoever has ears, let them hear what the Spirit says to the churches. He says, to the one who is victorious, I will give the right to eat from the tree of life, which is in the paradise of God. Repent and do the things you did at first. Find your first love again, your love for Jesus. Be excited about it. Be purposeful in what we do and how we do it. So we can produce fruit. They're actually pretty simple directions. He gets right to the point. He just says, turn around and do what you did at first. Go back to your first love, to serving your first love. Now, can we compare that to our lives in our church? Would some of this message match where we are today? Each of you might answer differently, like I said, depending on where you sit. Depending on what's going on in your life, where you're at in your life right now. Whether you're serving, whether you're unable to, whether you're feeling loved by the church or fellow Christians or not. Whether you're living for Christ right now or for yourselves. There's a whole lot that can go into how you feel about how we would answer these questions. But if we don't go back, and in this case, Jesus is warning to turn back. Because if not, their hearts will harden. The farther they fall, the worse it would get. Think about what he would say to us, to the church in Smithfield. What would he praise us for? What would he condemn us for? It's a lot to think about. But we have to be on guard, and that's why it's good to assess, because if we get lackadaisical, if we get content in what we're doing, it's easy for our hearts to get hardened. It allows that to slowly happen over time. It's never instantly. It's always a little bit here and a little bit there. I changed this or I've started to accept this and pretty soon we're gone. Pretty soon we've gone into a whole other lifestyle that we know is not right, but maybe it'll be all right. Our hearts slowly get hardened and we fail to see what God is doing around us because we're not looking for it anymore. Or we've got so far away from following that he's not doing much in our lives at the moment. So there's a lot that goes into that. And the best way is to pray for the protection of our hearts. To pray that we would continue to be drawn to him, that he would help protect us. Because he will. That we would protect each other, that we would pray for one another. Because we each need protection, we each need support, we each need to be lifted up. Because it's not something we can do by ourselves. To fight the battles of good and evil, to fight off Satan's attacks by ourselves is exhausting. And often we fail when we try to do it by ourselves. It's just too hard. And that's where God can use his people, can bring them together to love one another, to lift one another up. To go back to our first love. So think about that this week. Take this paper with you. Look at those questions. Think about that. I'll read them quick. You don't have to answer them today. I'll go through them real quick. What would the Lord praise our church about in this letter if it was to us? Our deeds. What are our deeds? Do we hate evil as they did? What would he praise us about? Are we living in a way that the Lord would bring praises upon us? What would he warn us about? What would he say, hey, just watch out for this one little thing. You know, you got to be careful. Do we still hold our first love? Are we still here for Jesus Christ? Are we still excited about having Jesus Christ in our lives? And overall, think about overall what we can take out of the letter to Ephesus. This is one, like I said, it's 107. So think about that. Pray about that and put your name in there as well. Like I said this week, as you're praying, put your name in there and read through that. All right. Well, let us close in a word of prayer and we'll prepare for our communion. Well, Heavenly Father, I thank you today, Lord, for your word. Lord, I pray that you spoke to whoever was here that needed to hear this, Lord. I know I did. So I thank you today, Lord. I praise you for your word, how it lives in us, Lord, how your spirit convicts us. I can't convict anybody, Lord. That's not my job. But that's your spirit. Father, and you prove that over and over again, that our job is to serve. Our job is to love, Lord, and you'll take care of the rest. Thank you for that this morning. I thank you for each one sitting here in these pews this morning, Lord, and I pray your blessing upon them today. And I ask this in Jesus' name. Amen.